morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Happy Creation Time 3, which is part of the season of Pentecost. And there are actually 5 weeks in all of the season of creation, of creation time, and it ends on Thanksgiving Sunday. We welcome everyone here present, and we also think about those who are reading the service at home and those who will join us online later. May this church be a space where each one of us feels safe and respected, a part of God's family. God created and cherishes our diversity in age, in gender, and sexual orientation, body build, health, and history. As we pray, as we work, as we sing, as we lament and celebrate, we do so as equal members of God's beloved kingdom. May this time be a sacred hour of community with God and with one another. We have some announcements, and we start with praying for Little Current United Church. And Reverend Whitney Bruno is at in Little Current. We pray for them today. We hope that you join us for refreshments downstairs after service. And if you haven't noticed, yes, it's obvious, it's Orange Shirt Day. We are reflecting on the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. So we continue to consider this color and what it means as we move through our service today and into Saturday, which is the actual day for Truth and Reconciliation on September 30th. We continue on with a Bible study, and that resumes from 10 to 11:30 on Tuesday. And you can find that link in your email. Tuesday night, we have a council meeting. We're back at it this fall, and it is hybrid. That means it's in the church downstairs, or you can do it take part on Zoom. And it's coming Thursday. Exciting. Hopefully you will be able to attend. It is our first supper church. We're going to do supper church September, October, and November. We're going to give it a try. I've been a part of these supper churches before, and it is a rich time where we gather simply in the lower hall and have a meal together, which is so typical of what Jesus did in his time. Sitting with friends, having a meal together, and we're going to worship as well as have a time of communion. And it's not for probably be around from 5:30 till 7 at the latest. So we look forward to folks coming to that. And invite a friend with you. On Thursday morning, reminder to our LST is that we have a meeting from 10 to 11:30 in the fellowship hall downstairs.
Friday
morning, the 29th, and Reverend McCallum will be coming, and she is my supervisor, so be on your best behavior. Okay, that's just for me. I'm confident you will be. We will be celebrating our Anglican neighbors, their 100th anniversary, pretty exciting, on October 1st. But at the back, we have a letter that we're going to be sharing with them. And so please take time to sign the card. And that is at the back. So please do that at the end of the service if you haven't done so already. On October 3rd, next Tuesday, Messy Church is on Tuesday. And it's from 6 to 7:30, and it's intergenerational. So if you've got little grands or children, or you just simply want to come yourself, it doesn't matter. Come with them or come alone. But it is a time of celebrating the season of creation. We're going to do that on Tuesday, next Tuesday. And finally, we have an outreach need. And SASE downtown, it's a Sudbury Action Center for Youth, may have heard of it. It's in great need of donations for vulnerable people. So there's a list of things that you could be maybe seeing in your home that you could be donating that you don't need, some cleaning out, or maybe families that know of these items, t-shirts, hoodies, pants, jogging pants, shampoos, toothpaste, conditioners. Please, the underwear and socks, please have them new out of the bag, in the bag. So we will provide a list of those items this coming week, and folks will be able to have a reminder, put it on your fridge or wherever, or share it with friends, please. But they are in desperate need. You can also monetarily donate as well, and you'd receive a tax receipt. They serve about 650 people a month. In my previous work, I brought some youth to Sassy. We had a meal together, and these are vulnerable youth that live on our streets in the downtown Sudbury core. We will now turn to hear our acknowledgement of territory. And if ever there was a day that we lean in to these words, it is today.
We gather for worship on land where Indigenous people have lived for thousands of years. This church is located on the traditional territory of the Wanapitaking and Anishinaabeg. We lament the damage that European colonization has had on First Nations, Inuit, and Métis communities. And we acknowledge that many Indigenous people still today live with intergenerational trauma, racism, and inequity. All who live in this area are parties to the Robinson-Huron Treaty, which outlines the shared rights and responsibilities connected to the care and use of the land. As a covenant people, we are called to honor promises. As a church, we have been called to a journey of learning, reconciliation, and reparation. As Christ people, we are called to love our neighbors. May God support and bless our commitment to live out these calls.
We light this Christ candle as a symbol of Christ's presence here with us today. But Christ is not just here in this place. Christ is with us always, wherever we go. May our lives be a faithful reflection of the one that we follow. So come, come and worship. You woke early, or you slept late. You who come often, or you who don't. Whether we are first or last, or somewhere in between, there is room for all of us in God's kingdom. And more than enough grace to go around. Let's worship God together. Let's pray together. We give thanks
for the land, for the lakes and rivers, for the hills and mountains, for the sand, soil, and rock we live upon. We give thanks for all our relations, for the fish, birds, and mammals, for the reptiles who crawl on the ground, and insects who buzz in the air. And on this day of national shame and necessary remembering, we acknowledge all that has caused so much pain because of the internal harm done by the United Church of Canada through the residential schools in Rim. It is with these mixed up and difficult feelings that we come to worship. We come to spend time with our Maker. Amen.
Thank you.
that can keep us separated from God. So let us make room for God in our lives. And with these words of confession, let's pray together. God of tender mercies,
we admit that sometimes we don't know what to do with ourselves. We anger at the slightest insult and imagine great vengeance on all those who wronged us. We laze about in the good news of our faith and do not consider the deep commitment of faith. We care for ourselves, but not for others. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us. Help us to repent and make us whole.
Amen.
So, siblings in Christ, let us proclaim the good news in Jesus that we are forgiven, we're reconciled, we're loved, and we're changed. Amen.
Amen.
And may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's greet each other with the peace of Christ. Christ. What is in Pastor Pam's bag today? Oh, goodness. Did anyone notice a different candle lit today when Marlene lit the candle?
I noticed.
Yeah. What does this look like to you?
Two people hugging.
Looks like two people hugging.
Yeah. Hands out.
Embracing, arms out.
Makes a circle.
It makes a circle, sure.
Yeah. They're the same.
They're
equal. Like there's balance.
Yeah. There's balance. Equal.
The flame's in the middle.
The flame is in the center.
It looks like they're warm.
Yeah, they do. They look warm.
It's an embrace, it's reaching. It's not just...
Right, yeah. Open. It reminds me, in indigenous cultures, I don't know if folks know, when they have things on their minds and on their hearts and they have to make decisions, what do they do? What's the first thing they do? And it might take years, it might take a long time to make this decision. Does anyone know what they do to make that significant? It kind of looks like what's in the middle of this.
They light a fire?
Yes, they light a fire. They light a sacred fire. For us, when we light the Christ candle, and this is the Christ candle today, our Christ is at the center. And wow, wouldn't that be amazing if every time we have issues, concerns, challenges, things we need to decide upon as a community that we need to work together, that Christ is always in the center. I'm going to invite Allison up. Everyone received some sage when they came in. So Allison's going to share a bit about sage.
Well, if you know me at all, you know that if I'm asked to do something, it's like, how much information can I give you? So talk about sage. There's literally thousands of pages written about sage. It's an amazing herb. It's been around, and any culture that has it growing anywhere near them has used it forever. The Egyptians used it. The Romans used it. My grandmother used it. And it's interesting that they're all different kinds. Like there's 90 odd different kinds of sage. So the sage that you've got today, there's two different kinds. isn't the same sage that indigenous people use. It isn't the same sage that is used in, say, Navajo country, which, by the way, the Navajos used sage when people were sick. They just burned it, like over coals or in a fire, in the room where the people were sick. And in our culture, we have finally figured out that that was the right thing to do because sage kills germs. And you're just going, well, okay. But it took us, we thought that was a dumb thing to do until the microbiologist went, you know what? That's actually the right thing to do. It's a good thing to do. It's healthy. And what I found mostly interesting is there's a sage that I couldn't find called desert sage. It's been revered by First Peoples forever. And smoke from white sage, which is an artemisia if you're a gardener, is used for purification. It's to purify the mind, the body, and the spirit. And any sacred or important article before there's prayers or ceremonies. What really creeped me out, though, was in 1876, the Canadian government put into law what was called the Indian Act, and it outlawed, like make it illegal for indigenous ceremonies, religious, or cultural practices. And you know, this is 1876, that's no big deal, right? What if that was today? What if that was me? What if I'm not allowed to have a religious ceremony? What if it's illegal for me to go to a group Bible study? What if it's illegal for me to have communion? What if it's illegal to have my baby baptized? And when I started thinking about that, it was like, yes, those ceremonies are different from my ceremonies. That religion is different from the one that I practice. But you can't do that to people, I think. Like, what in your life, like, would it have been like for you not to be able to practice a religious or culturally significant ceremony? My grandmother once put her hand on my head and said, bless you. That would have been illegal. Like, how horrible is that? Like, just drives me nuts. That didn't end until 1960. That's not very long ago. All of us were born before 1960. Now, one of the things that indigenous people do is that smudging thing. And I'm pretty sure, although I can't prove it, that people kept those ceremonies alive. I mean, the people who are going to put you in jail for it aren't there all the time. So I'm supposing that people kept that practice of smudging alive. They knew how to make that smudge, is that what it's called? Smudge stick? They knew how to do that so that when 1960 happened, somebody knew how to do that. You cannot stop people from praying. Maybe they're not going to do it out loud, but you can't stop prayer. Maybe if I'm in the hospital and it's illegal for Faye to come and visit me and pray with me out loud, she could come to the hospital, take my hand, and pray. And God's going to hear it. And I'm convinced personally that indigenous people kept a lot of their practices. Like the old people would have to do it because a lot of the young people got taken away. But there was that core that was left. So that when we come now to smudging, which is kind of a cool thing to do, we need to think about why we're doing it. Because for a while back there, when I was in my, a while back there, feng shui was the big cool thing to do. And nobody thought twice about it. It's a Chinese thing, but oh well. Or it's a Japanese thing to do this with a little cat that says hello. Or it's a cool thing to have a little Buddha in your house. Smudging isn't a bad thing to do. It's cleansing. It's clearing. For Indigenous people, it's holy. So we need to think personally, if we do this kind of stuff, we need to think about why. Why are we doing it? Are we doing it because it's kind of cool? Or are we doing it to purify? Like, I think intent is everything. And the intent for smudging for Indigenous people was to purify before the ceremony, before the religious rite. They used sweet grass, and out west they used red cedar, because sage wasn't a big thing on the west coast, but red cedar was. So any kind of questions? When you go home with your little piece of sage, maybe just rub it and get that scent in your nose and think about some of the things that I said. Think about what it's like. And there's nothing wrong with burning your piece of sage. The Navajo will tell you, it'll get the germs out.
Thank you, Melissa. There are teachers all around us. Let's do just that. Let's put our hands out and pretend that we are imagining ourselves holding each other's hands, that we are close together, and pray the prayer that Jesus taught. Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
So Chief Seattle, back in the 1800s, said, "Man did not weave the web of life. He is merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does to himself." And that particular phrase was the inspiration for the hymn. This is a new hymn written by Maria Case from Toronto, and it is in our new hymn anthology that's coming for our centennial year in the United Church. So we'll sing this twice, and I'll play it once first.
I'm
hearing new music, and it's exciting, because if it's anything like some of those lyrics, we are in for some beautiful gifts. We want to thank, first of all, we want to give thanks for a new choir member. And am I saying Elisa's name right?
Elisa.
She is going home and excited about being with the choir. And so are we. Yes. And we also need to give thanks for the new hymn collection that Faye speaks about, Then Let Us Sing, is what it's called. Then Let Us Sing. And we're going to hear more of that music over the next few months.
Sing it.
Oh, yeah.
We're trying it out. We're sampling. They want to know your opinions.
Okay. That being said, we need to be incredibly grateful for our Minister of Music, Faye Moffitt, who has embraced this wholeheartedly and has been in some of the building of this work, and we are incredibly excited about it. And somebody recently told me that Faye is celebrating 35 years of music ministry in this place. So we are incredibly grateful. And we're going to turn to our minute for mission, our minute for right relations today. And this, we are grateful for Carol Germa, who goes to St. Peter's United in Sudbury, and she wrote this. We've got one of the books here, and it's about why we wear orange today. So Phyllis was delighted. Phyllis was delighted with the bright orange shirt that her grandmother gave her to wear on that first day of school at the St. Joseph's Mission Residential School in British Columbia. But when Phyllis arrived at the school, her clothes were taken away and she was given a uniform. Phyllis never saw that orange shirt again. She was very hurt and left with feelings of worthlessness. A reunion of the school was held in 2013. And events designed to commemorate the residential school experience, to witness and honor the healing journey of survivors and their families, and to commit to the ongoing process of reconciliation. Phyllis Jack Webstead told the story of her orange shirt in that reunion. Since then, every year on Orange Shirt Day is held on September 30th, the time of the year when children were taken from their homes to residential schools. It is an opportunity for children and adults to learn about the effects of residential schools and the legacy that was left behind. We show our commitment to reconciliation by wearing an orange shirt today and on September 30th, the National Day of Truth and Reconciliation. And you can get more information about that if you look on your email, your weekly email. You can click that link and you can see more about it. We are grateful for the Canadian Shield Right Relations Committee. So God says that we do not decide who is worthy of the gifts we share. We are to give freely and abundantly, that the last shall be first and the first last. Let us now do as God does and share with everyone as we make our offering. Let us pray. Abundant God, we ask you to help us look beyond the labels we put on people and their circumstances, and see the faces of young children, so that we can lift up those who struggle and share what we have with them. Bless these gifts and those given online and through PAR for all who are in need. Amen.
So this song that we're going to sing tells a story. Some of our hymns tell stories.
It tells the story of the widow's mite, so one parable. Then it tells the story of Zacchaeus the tax collector, whom Jesus visits in his house for supper, which is a turnaround. And then it tells the story of our scripture today, the laborers in the vineyards. The chorus of this story, or the chorus of this song, I want you to listen very carefully as you're singing it. And the music itself, on the words where it says, with God the world is turned upside down, listen to the way the whole rhythm changes on those words, upside down. Don't be surprised. The end of that chorus says, let's work for a world where all people are free, where it's good to feel good about God loving you and me. And I think at one point when I used to read this chorus, I thought, it's a little bit superficial just to say, oh, it's good to feel good about God loving us, good to feel good about loving you and me. But this week I was in Sudbury where there was a rally of people who were shouting very angry things and other people who were saying, you know, love not hate and that sort of thing. I could not believe how some people cannot look at another human being and see a human being. They see a demon, and that was on their signs. And so when I went back and was preparing for choir practice and I read this line, let's work for a world where all people are free, where it's good to feel good about God loving you and me, I was thinking, I hope that it can be a world where God loves every you and every me, and where we can all see, like we say in our opening statement in the morning, we are all precious, beloved children of God, and may we all see each other that way.
For the day, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received a denarius. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." For this reading from Scripture, thanks be to God, and by God's grace, we hear a living word in it. Amen.
So we're going to do some things a little bit differently today with part of the sermon. So what we're first going to see on the screen is our United Church crest. And I'm just going to briefly have us take a look at that. And if you want to get some details about the United Church crest and when it changed, there's some detail in your email this week. But just to point out that the Indigenous community has been clearly identified in our United Church crest. We look at the north, at the white, we looked at the east in the yellow, we looked south in the black, and we looked west to the red. This mirrors the medicine wheel of the Indigenous peoples. So that is clearly identified in the crest. We also see that up the right-hand side is a Mohawk phrase. If you've never seen it before, it is there. And we can practice saying this together, because I'm not doing it alone. But the words are Akwe, Akwe, Ne, De, De, Wa, Ni, Ne, Ne, Re, Ren. Let's try that together.
Akwe, Ne, De, De, Wa, Ne,
Re. Yes. What does it mean? It means all my relations. So whenever you see the United Church crest, we've got one outside, take a look at it. We see the Mohawk phrase, all my relations. We're going to do a little bit of an experiment, so to speak, before we get into our scripture reading. We're going to look at this side of the congregation and this side of the congregation, and you're two groups of people. And I'm going to be the Indigenous community over here, and Faye is going to represent the colonizers. So, Indigenous people, group, my group. I've been living peacefully. We've been living peacefully on our land from the beginning of time. And the environment we live in is lush and it's beautiful. And we've been living off the land, always ensuring that we never took more than what we needed. Our core values, our relationships, and reciprocity with each other and the land.
We don't believe in the concept of ownership. We don't even know what the word is. We don't have it in our language. Instead, we believe that everything is shared and that we have been given the task of looking after the land and all living things. That's what we've been doing. That's what we've been living. And one day, we notice a strange group of people, different from us. They arrive on the land. And this other group looks different. They act different, they speak different, a different language. And due to our core values and of relationship and reciprocity, we welcome these strangers. And we offer them our hospitality of gifts, lodging, and food. And we offer to share our land with kindness and humility. Then we begin to notice that this strange new people, they're very different. They appear to want to negotiate, but we're unable to fully understand what they're even asking. We don't have the language or the words. We don't have money to buy, to purchase, to sell, and we're unable to comprehend what these concepts even mean. This is our world, isn't it?
My nation has been experiencing horrible living conditions for many decades. It's reached the point where we have no more resources to sustain the number of people on this land. So we decided that we needed to leave our land and travel to another place, hoping to find resources so that we could rebuild an empire, our empire. Things that are important to us, I suppose you could call them our core values, are our money. We need it. An economy that's based on, well, it's a hierarchy. There are people higher and lower, and some dominate others. That's reality. Now, make no mistake, I am devotedly religious, and so are my people. But sometimes we've had to resort to force, even violence, to assert our domain over others. And yes, I'll admit that we've used fear to control anybody who thinks differently. We believe, and it's part of our religion, that everything living on the land has been put there for our use. That's what dominion means, isn't it? After traveling a great distance, we arrived at a new land. Right away, we realized, oh, how lush and beautiful it was. We kind of thought it was a new Eden. We were excited to find all the resources that were in that land, and we just thought, this is where we can make our great and mighty empire again. We already had an elaborate system of trade, and we had taken some resources from other places, so we thought maybe that would work here. But our excitement at the beginning turned to frustration quickly because we discovered another nation of people living there. Now, we do believe that we are the superior race. When we met these people, we really, at first glance, we thought that they were uncivilized and savage. And, well, yes, you know, we speak different languages, but we did try to negotiate with them so that we could secure land for our nation. We're experienced negotiators, and we could be known for a certain aggression in our tactics, so we insisted on contracts. We wanted to have things nailed down, contracts in order to purchase their land. They don't seem to be much more than primitive, and so we thought, well, we can probably purchase their land for not very much money.
So we have two different worlds sitting together. How does it feel to have a side picked for you? How do you feel, colonizers? I see some shaking heads. Indigenous communities.
Sad.
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 This is the reality that has taken place across Turtle Island. It's important that we continue to speak about it so that we can have understanding, even though we don't understand, because we haven't walked in that world. Yet at times, potentially, we may very well look like colonizers every day, depending on how we treat each other, and what we say to each other. We're going to look now at today's parable. So, parables. Jesus enjoyed speaking in parables. It's a story today that illustrates a moral or spiritual lesson. That's what a parable is, told by Jesus throughout the Gospels. But Matthew, there's a fair bit of parable there. In Matthew 13, Jesus says that he uses parables to speak to the people because they listen, but they don't hear or understand. So, blessed are your eyes because they see, and blessed are your ears because they hear. So says Jesus. Most parables start in one way. For the kingdom of heaven is like. Sound familiar? That's how parables start. So we're going to go through this parable. And everyone was given a color at the beginning when you walked in. What color did you get? If I can share this. Green. Let's not. You don't have to get up. Okay. So I'm going to go through the parable. And what's going to happen is I'm the landowner. And when you're chosen, when your color comes up, well, you're going to go out into the fields. And the expectation is you're going to start working in that field. So when your color comes up, you're going to start picking grapes, and you're going to start hoeing that land, okay? That's your responsibility. You were hired, after all. So for the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them out to the vineyard. So who has an orange? Oh, we got an orange over here, orange over there. Okay, start picking and start hoeing. Okay? You can just where you're sitting. Okay, all right, let's continue on. So when he went out at 9 o'clock, to the marketplace. Oh, keep doing your work, people. He saw others standing idle. And he said to them, "You also go up into the vineyard, and I'll pay you what is right." So who's got a yellow? Okay, start working, people. All right. Start picking, start hoeing. All right. When he went out again at noon, and about 3 o'clock. So who's from noon hour? We've got blue. Folks who have blue and a lighter blue. You can start working. And folks at 3 o'clock. Folks at 3 o'clock were picked as well. And they are the purple. They are the burgundy. Okay. Keep picking. I hope the people from early in the day are picking. Yeah, looks like it. And then he went back out at 5 o'clock. And he went and found others standing around still. And he said to them, "Why are you standing idle all day?" And they said to him, "No, because no one has hired us." And he said to them, "Because no one has hired us, because no one has hired you, go out. Go out. It's 5 o'clock, but go out." So all the people that are green, start doing your thing. Start picking, start working. So now, when it came time at the end of the day, and we've got anybody with a dark blue, might be a dark blue, end of the day. There was, they were on their last hour. So those folks at 5 o'clock had done their work as well. And then they gathered. And the heat was scorching. And people's clothes were soaked. And the landowner said, it's time to get paid. So he told the manager to gather folks and pay them. But he told them that the ones that started to work at the end of the day were going to be paid first. So, yeah, they're gonna go to the front of the line and get paid. And what they were paid was the same amount that, wow, folks who had the orange, who had been picking all day long, were paid. They were all paid the same. How do you feel about that? Yeah. Yeah, exactly, Judy. Yeah. Yes. And then folks that came out at 9, and folks that came out at noon, and folks that came out at 3 were all paid the same. And what about the folks at 5 o'clock? Who were the folks at 5 that came out and worked for an hour? Okay. What do you think of that?
Good deal.
Good deal. Some people think it's a good deal. Yeah. Arms sore? Tired? How does it feel? What word comes to mind right off the bat?
Unfair.
Unfair. Yeah. Unfair. Unfair. This was the landowner's decision. This was the manager's decision. That the last shall be first and the first shall be last. So says Jesus' parable. Let's hear more about that as we move back to our spots. So, Trinity, fall is officially here, as of yesterday, on the calendar that is, but growing up, a sure sign of fall came early in my house. As school would start up, my mom would break out the undershirts and the infamous cod liver oil pills. They were in the shape of footballs and filled with this liquid that was supposed to cure all. So who knows what cod liver oil tastes like? Okay, yeah. Not good, right? And some might say that it's just downright offensive. Well-known theologian Barbara Brown Taylor says that the parable of the laborers in the vineyard that we heard, that we just lived through, is a little like cod liver oil. You know Jesus is right. You know it must be good for you. But that doesn't make it any easier to swallow. This is a story that's so radical, so absurd even, that it seems it rewards those who have put in the minimum work and those who have kicked butt all day were sent to the end of the line. Sounds unfair. Feels unfair. Especially if we were the ones picking first thing in the morning. Maybe you were the ones that were waiting in the marketplace, overlooked at 9, overlooked at noon, overlooked at 3, overlooked all day. Perhaps it was because of the way you were hunched over that you weren't picked. Maybe it was the color of your skin or the language you spoke.
or the way you dressed, or the ink tattoos that you had in your arms, or even the way you styled your hair. You weren't picked. Can you picture yourself in that marketplace? Where might you be waiting? At the front, assured that you will be picked first? But I mean, stuff happens, right? Businesses fail. People fall in hard times. We get sick. Relationships tank. Or someone dies. Do we see the person around us? Do we see the people around us, the faces around us? Or is it us that I just described? It's one of us. Are we staring at the back of someone's head in that line while we're waiting? Or are we at the front of that line, feeling like we have earned a front row seat and that we are first? We can see that this parable sits just before another Matthew story, where the mother of James and John come to Jesus and make this special case and say to Jesus, you know, I'd really like my sons to have the best thrones in the kingdom, one to Jesus' left and one to Jesus' right. Now Jesus politely responds to this mother and says, you don't know what you're talking about, because his throne is not made of jewels or gold. Jesus says, mine is made out of wood and nails and in the shape of a cross. Barbara Round Taylor shares that Jesus' very own disciples are jockeying for position when they're waiting for a good seat in the kingdom of heaven, competing for the best spot. Each one of them trying to be first in line at the door when heaven's gate pops open. Jesus' message is the last shall be first and the first last. By turning what we think it should be right on its head. Our lectionary from Season Fusion, our resource that we use, shares that there's a wilderness of unemployment, and the landowner who acts in surprising ways reminds us that God's generosity does not follow human reasoning. It doesn't. God's generosity is unlimited and reveals God's justice. We know all too well that life is unfair. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Life is unfair.
Amen.
So it's good to know that in all of the unfairness we endure, that God is fair. And I suppose we can say that when we are at the front of the line. Yeah? We can say God's fair when we're at the front of the line. And if we get paid what we think we deserve, yes, God's fair. Taylor ends with this comment that stops me cold, reminding me that actually God isn't fair. She proclaims God is not fair. God is generous. God is not fair. God is generous. And when we begrudge that generosity, it is only because we have forgotten where we're standing. Have us look around, God says, at all that God has provided us. This most generous God. A God who loves you and me. Yes, every you and every me. Amen. Let's pray. God, this day, there are so many prayers that tumble down for people and places, circumstances. We consider all those who face the injustices of residential schools. May the telling of Phyllis's story have us continue to work to reconcile all of the long-standing residue colonization has played on the lives of your people. In our communities, close and far, we pray that your compassion be felt with the LGBTQ plus spirit persons and victims of racism who are suffering the continuance of hate and violence. God, would you surround them and all allies in your compassion and love. For those countries across your world, issues and circumstance too numerous to count. God, we grieve Libya, where the death toll is now nearly 4,000. For wildfires in Australia, tornadoes in China. We pray for people who are suffering violence in India. And we pray to you by calling out the evils of war with the Russian aggression upon Ukraine. May peace-building efforts replace the focus of supplying more deadly weapons. We pray that the peace, God, Holy One, we ask you to continue to hold the lives of those left behind in your unshakable arms. In our strength, when we are weak, God, we hold many people today who continue to grieve, loved ones who we miss and long for. We pray for the family of Reverend Don Van Eyck, for the congregation of St. Peter's, as she served for 30 years, for clergy and siblings in Christ who have loved her. We ask for your comfort and care over tender hearts this day. We ask for healings to those who are close. We pray for Joni in hospital. We pray for Karen and for Nash and all those we know need your care at this time. For your people, our Creator, have us be drawn into both our times of great despair and in praise for all things good. We offer our prayers now to you, God, in the silence of our hearts. Lord, hear our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
here as workers in God's upside down kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, where needs are met in miraculous ways, where gifts of God are recognized, and there is grace enough for all. And may the blessing of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit surround you and sustain you in the coming days. Amen.
Amen.